Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It seems like it's been such an incredibly long time. When were we last here? And I know somebody's going to say it, so I'll say it kind of late. I think it was last year that we were here. So, at any rate, today is January 11th. Welcome to this edition of the Forum. We have an exciting program for you. And just give me a couple of seconds for a quick number of announcements. Those of you that were there last Thursday, you already know this. For the first effort with our partners, the Portland City Club, we just had a wonderful turnout at the Beaverton Library for a wonderful panel. It was pretty darn wonderful, I've used the word twice, for a wonderful panel at that library discussing water issues. Very well attended. I counted over 60 people. Eric counted over 67 people, but he was counting the panel. It was just really an excellent informational evening with talented, knowledgeable people and very, very well organized. We really appreciate the efforts of the City Club, and one of our board members worked very, very hard to put our input into it and to come up with a wonderful evening. And I really would like a round of applause for Spencer Edmund, who is sitting right there. You did an excellent job. Thanks very much. And ladies and gentlemen, we have some real exciting things coming up. I believe the date is April 6th. Board Member Phil, is that correct? Is it April 6th or April 7th? It's a Tuesday. April 5th. Okay, thank you. April 5th, we have a secret presentation coming at the Cedar Mill Library. And if you pay attention, you'll learn about that later, but please mark the date. It's the evening, 6 o'clock, I believe, is the start time. Oops, okay, I don't remember anything well. 7 o'clock is the start time, and as you watch some of the bulletins that come out and check our website, you will learn what's happening on that date. And ladies and gentlemen, January 4th, there was a big storm, and I think most of you who were here will remember that storm. It was kind of unpleasant. It was difficult to make a decision. It's the first time in my life I felt like Portland Public Schools, but nonetheless, we did decide to cancel, and the reason was mostly for everyone's safety. We were very fortunate. We called our speakers that day, and they both said that they could come on January 18th, Martin Luther King Day, which is a day that we might ordinarily not have something. It is a holiday, but we thought we would bring them back. It turns out that Joe Gallegos, who was going to join us for that presentation, is unable to be here, but Susan McLean will fill in for him, and Representative Julie Parrish. The two of them will be discussing the upcoming legislative session in February and kind of give us an advanced, insightful look. That's what we're looking forward to on the 18th. That's been corrected on the website, and I just wanted to make sure everybody was aware of that. It's not a day off for us. Should be a very, very interesting day. But no more interesting than today. Today we're very fortunate to have Mr. Erik Lukens from the Oregonian Editorial Department. He, I understand, will be giving us a short presentation to tell us what most of us are quite interested in learning. How does it work out there anyway? And then there'll be time for questions. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Lukens, thank you, sir.
Well, thanks a lot for having me here today. It's your privilege. Mike, can you hear me? Okay. Let me know if I'm talking too loud because I can back off. I'll just speak very briefly about the way the editorial department works, just the nuts and bolts, and then I'll just say a few words about our annual editorial agenda, which we just rolled out on Sunday, and we're going to have the individual editorials throughout the next couple of weeks. And then I'll answer any questions you want to ask me. So first, there are four of us currently on the editorial board. There's me, of course, I'm the editorial page editor. There's Helen Jung, Len Reed, and then our company president, Steve Moss. The three of us writers, everyone except for Steve Moss, do the actual editorial writing. Steve is there as our supervisor and an occasional participant in editorial board meetings. And we also have a separate letters editor, page designer, who works exclusively with the editorial board. So functionally, there are four of us. Our purpose is to provide a forum for discussion about important issues and to lead that discussion by writing about those issues ourselves. And ideally, people do what we say, but often they don't. So you hope to have some sort of an influence, but that's really not up to us. The most we can do is you know, encourage people to discuss important issues and provide a forum for people to respond themselves. Our scope is entirely local and state. We figured we can provide value on local and state issues. We do not write, by and large, on national or international issues. We leave that to syndicated columnists. We have an array of them. And we figured that's the way we can provide the most value to readers. That's where our expertise is, and you know, that's how we can use the contacts that we have you know, in Oregon and in the Portland area. Like all editorial pages everywhere, we have a point of view where we don't pretend that we're not biased, because we are in fact biased. That's the point. I guess I would describe our point of view as kind of sort of libertarian, even though Steve Buckstein would probably cringe. Do you cringe, Steve?
No, we'll talk.
Okay. Socially, we're pretty liberal. We're pro-marriage equality. We support abortion rights. We supported marijuana legalization. And fiscally, we're somewhat conservative. That's kind of sort of libertarian. We tend to focus on the costs of public policies, public programs, as well as their benefits. Now, how do we operate? Now, we do not have an independent budget. However, we operate completely independently of the rest of the news organization at the Oregonian. The purpose of this, of course, is to avoid the appearance and the fact of influence. Nobody wants to, nobody wants the idea that the terrible people on the editorial page are influencing news coverage. So the way it works is I answer directly to Steve Moss, who's the president of the company. I do not report to Mark Katchis, who's the VP of content, who is effectively the editor of the news operations. And we do talk with reporters. We share documents. You know, it would be silly to sort of hoard documents. And we're very collegial. We sit in the same newsroom, but we have our own independent meetings. We don't plan coverage together, and they generally don't ask us what we're up to, and we tend not to ask them what they're up to. And occasionally you can tell, you know, we'll have an editorial that doesn't run in completely in synchronicity with a story, and it'll look kind of strange, and that's the reason. We just don't plan together. And what do we do besides writing editorials? Now, the three of us who are the editorial writers do a lot of other things as well. We edit and post the work of other people. My two colleagues do most of the syndicated work. I handle all guest columns, which are columns written by readers that we print. We spend a lot of time during elections interviewing people who are running for office. Whatever offices we decide to endorse in, we will interview all candidates in contested races. And we tend to have two people present at every meeting so that you don't just get one person's point of view. So you can see how that can take up a lot of time, you know, in March and April and also September and October. That's basically what we do. I'm happy to answer questions about that over there. That's a kind of high-level view. And I'll talk just for a couple of minutes about our editorial agenda, which is something that we started doing in 2013. I arrived in 2012 from Bend. And in 2013, we launched our first agenda, kind of as a way to introduce readers to sort of the direction of the new editorial page. I think we're more of a hard-driving, hard-edged editorial page than the page was under my predecessor. And also to sort of give people a sense of what our ideology was. So what do we look for? Our editorial agenda tends to be about 6 or 7 items, and these are issues that we consider in the coming year that we believe will be particularly important for one reason or another, and in which we think that people ought to be talking about and thinking about. And they tend to be, we're on our fourth year now, and agenda items tend to be a mix of the very general and the very specific. And the general agenda items tend to be things in which most people seem to agree, or need some work. Education has been there in one form or another for 4 years. Jobs, the economy, those are the things that tend to repeat. But every year we have a few specific agenda items that are key largely to what the legislature might or might not do in the coming year. Back in 2013, I don't know if you can all remember, that was the year in which PERS reform was the thing that the legislature did. It was the overwhelming focus of the legislature. So that was one of our agenda items, and we wrote about, it was fixed PERS. We wrote about PERS over and over and over again. And the legislature, under the guidance of Governor Kitzhaber, really did a good job. The Supreme Court later threw out most of the reforms, but that wasn't their fault. We also included, this seems to be such distant memory now, Build the Bridge, which was urging the legislature to build the Columbia River Crossing. That didn't turn out so well. We also have, so the specific things tend to change from year to year. And I would also say that we have one agenda item every year, in this year too, that are largely values, I call them values. And for a few years, it was protect and enhance personal liberty. And initially, this agenda item was key to the potential legalization of same-sex marriage and also to marijuana legalization, although there were a number of other areas in which people's liberty was under, in our view, was under threat, large and small. And after 2014, when, in fact, same-sex marriage was legalized and marijuana, recreational marijuana use was legalized, we sort of scrapped it. We're bringing it back this year, in part because there's really nothing really big, but in 2015, a number of things happened that made us realize that you really can't stop watching these, can't stop watching. And one of them was, it was the Labor Commissioner Brad Avakian's finding in response to, it was his finding that the owners of Sweet Cakes by Melissa, a bakery that whose owners had refused to bake the wedding cake for a same-sex couple, his finding that they had essentially promised or told people that they would not in the future serve gays and lesbians, which was actually not, that finding was not borne out by anything in his report, essentially. And he overruled an administrative law judge in doing so, and we found that completely appalling. And it is an instance, I think, in which people in power can wrong even those who have themselves have done wrong. Now, in our view, the bakery owners were wrong to refuse to bake the cake, but they were done wrong by Brad Avakian, and that's something that bothered us. We wrote a couple editorials on it, and we'll continue to follow that in the coming year, in part because he's running for Secretary of State. Another new item this year is Get Oregon Centered, and I would say that is also kind of a values item, and it is a response to, I suppose it would, the right way to say it would be, the excesses that can come from single party control of state government, which we saw in the 2015 legislative session and might this year. And the intent is to encourage legislators to find centrist solutions or bipartisan solutions to various issues. I think that's about it. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have about our agenda, the way we work, and anything else.
Commissioners, we'll line up over here. Just a fast reminder, folks. All you need to ask questions of Mr. Lukens is a paid-up membership. So this is our moment where we try and encourage you to find Erik, who is standing over there, and at the last minute, you can't line up until you pay. Anyway, I don't mean to be overly silly about it, but please feel free to line up, and Mr. Lukens is
checking two
questions.
We're live.
And it looks like you invited Steve, and Steve is accepting your invitation. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
Jim Cape, four member. Question about what it seems to be a 21st century journalism student career strategy is you work for a couple years for a local media company and then you become a PR person for a local government. So can you discuss the sincerity of this, of the local journalism students?
I can't speak really for local journalism students. I can only speak for the folks I've met and the folks I've worked with over the years. And I think that your question suggested that it was a deliberate choice in career path that these folks might, they might, you know, just sort of work for a news organization for a couple of years as a way of sort of getting themselves out there to get a job at a, for the government. That's not what I see in practice. I think that the people who go into journalism do so knowing that it doesn't pay well, that, you know, the job market isn't as steady as it might be, but they do it because they really like it. You know, I think that this is an avocation, and people do this job despite knowing the risks of doing it. And, you know, at some point people have to make decisions in their lives about, you know, whether they want to keep doing something that might not be that stable and might not pay that much, or trade some of the things that they enjoy for the stability that comes from, or, you know, a PR job in the government. I mean, I don't think that people deliberately choose that as sort of a career trajectory. I think that they go into journalism because they really like it, and it's a, you know, it's a lot of fun, and they can make a difference. And if they end up doing something else later on, that's because of a failure in the journalism world, not a failure, I guess, in their career path. So.
Steve Buckstein, forum member. I think we've talked about this before, but I just want to ask, because I think people here may be interested. The Oregonian and many news organizations are moving more to online content, and as you said, you're encouraging discussion. You're writing editorials and hoping people are going to weigh in and discuss what you're talking about. But the Oregonian and many other organizations, not all of them, allow anonymous commentary. I mean, you can create a screen name that nobody knows who you are. And in my view, that dumbs, I don't know if you call it, dumbs down the discussion, but basically allows for a lot of rude comments and off-topic comments and not, I've talked to people who don't read the comments anymore because it's just back and forth attacking people and, you know, ad hominem attacks. I always post using my own name and I get attacked
right,
for it, but
yeah.
I guess the question is why that policy, and would you consider changing that policy to require that people use their real names?
The first thing to know is that it's not a, that's not an Oregonian level decision. We are owned by Advanced Communications in New Jersey, and that's something over which we have no control. That's an advanced policy. And as far as their rationale, first of all, I agree with you. It does, you know, people are emboldened to be rude and abusive. I'm a pretty avid participant in comments, and I see that all the time. And there is a moderating function, but it's not perfect. But as to the rationale for it, I think, you know, I've asked, you know, I've gone to New Jersey and talked to the advanced folks and asked them about this. And I think their argument is that it opens up the discussion to a lot of people who, because of their personal circumstances, their job circumstances, might not feel free to comment unless they had anonymity, that you would be screening out a lot of people who might have thoughtful comments, who can only comment because they're anonymous. So I imagine it's a way of trading off, you know, you're sort of weighing the pros and cons, and you know what they've come up with is a model that allows the greatest number of people to say the whatever they like, with in sort of an imperfect moderation function. You know, it does have kind of a rude Wild West feel at times, and you have, you know, in practice you have a small number of frequent flyers, and we notice this on the editorial page because we have a distinct point of view, and there are people who just really don't like our distinct point of view, and they tell us that very, you know, very bluntly at times, and they, you know, there are probably a dozen people who really hate our guts, and they let us know, but you know, we deal with it. Yeah, it isn't perfect.
My name is Bill Kroger. I'm a forum member. Do you have anything to do with letters to the editor?
I do. I am ultimately responsible for letters to the editor.
I was wondering if you could maybe talk about your selection process and how that goes about.
The person who actually handles them is our letters editor, who works for me. But generally, our selection process is to try to get a selection of points of view from people who live in, you know, don't all live in Portland, and on a range of topics that it might be of interest to readers. that's about as much as I can say about the process. What I can say is that the number of letters to the editor, going back to Steve's point, letters to the editor have declined as online commenting has increased. I think we found that a number of people, they know that if they can comment online instantly and participate with the person who might have written a story or an editorial, that gives them more than, you know, writing a letter. You know, you have to write the thing down, you got to send it, and, you know, it doesn't appear for a week. So online commenting has decreased the numbers of letters to the editor in the paper, or at least not the numbers of letters in the paper, but the numbers of letters that we have to choose from.
Hello, John McWilliams, forum member. I'm thinking about Harney County, the Freedom Act. How does the editorial board look at that situation going on down there right now?
Well, we've written a couple of editorials about it. We wrote two last week, and I guess the simplest, most direct editorial, the response was, as far as the occupation is concerned, that's simply inappropriate and shouldn't be happening. It doesn't respect, or doesn't reflect what people in Harney County want. There's no indication that it does. And that those people ought to just go away. And the second response, and we've written an editorial on each of these, is that the people in Harney County are in Eastern Oregon. I worked in Bend from 1998 to 2012, and I saw a lot of this stuff. You know, I looked at lawsuit after lawsuit. They're not crazy to be frustrated. They have every reason to be frustrated. That isn't to suggest that every government regulation is bad or that every environmental challenge is wrong. But, you know, I can understand how they're frustrated.
Okay, well, thank you. I appreciate your comments on that. Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, I'm Sarah Dubinsky, and I'm an avid letter to the editor writer, and have gotten quite a few letters actually published.
Thanks for writing.
You're very welcome. But that's not my, that's just, and I just became a forum member. So I could you please define fiscally conservative? Because I never understood the term. To me, it means you want to get rid of Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, cut public financing, you know, privatize everything, and yet you're okay about, you know, as a social, how did you put it, you know, libertarian, gay marriage, you know, pro-abortion. So on social issues, choice, on conservative issues, cut everything. But that's my understanding. So if I'm wrong about that, please educate me.
Yeah, we don't want to get rid of Social Security. I'd like to have it someday.
Okay.
I think if you look at what I mean by that in practice, you know, one example is recently Multnomah County decided that it would, Multnomah County Commission decided that it would offer paid parental leave to employees. And this was, you know, I think they were the first municipality or county in this area to do anything like that. It was very popular. I mean, the employees liked it, and it was a unanimous decision, I think, by the commission. But what we did is, you know, and I think what they did is they said, okay, if you have a child or you adopt a child, you know, each parent can have 6 weeks of paid leave. And what we did is we said, well, okay, what happens now? And the fact is, their employees have the ability to accrue sick time and vacation time from year to year, which is something that is very common in the public sector, but not in the private sector. And in fact, most people, even last year, who had taken time off for parental leave, actually got paid parental leave. And the actual effect of the new policy will be to allow the continued accrual of those, the vacation and sick time, which will be paid out. Either it'll affect PERS, there will also be a lump sum payout on retirement. So it's a willingness to look at the actual costs and trade-offs that and to be honest about the costs that come with policies, and to call into question things that might be popular. And I think that, you know, this does not make us particularly popular in some places. Mm-hmm. But I mean, I think that sort of rigor is something that you don't see enough of, you know, in Portland and Multnomah County. I think that's a valuable role that we serve.
So bookkeeping.
That's one way to look at it. Yeah, I mean, we are very eager to look at the costs of programs as well as their benefits. And I think that that's not something that a lot of other people are.
Okay, one more quick question. Why did you get rid of Paul Krugman, like the one liberal progressive voice in the whole editorial section?
Oh, that's not true. We have EJD on. We have a lot of people in the Washington Post who are liberal. The reason we ended our subscription to the New York Times News Service, and we get our syndicated columnists largely from two places. There's the New York Times, and then there's the Washington Post, Bloomberg. And there are a number of, first of all, New York Times was extremely expensive. The news service was something that was available to the entire news operation, but it was really used only by the editorial page because the content, the stories, not the opinion stories, tended to be too long to use in the paper. They took a lot of work to cut down. Mm-hmm. So it was something for which the organization was paying a lot of money. It was used really only by the editorial staff or the editorial page. And we really couldn't use them online. We had the ability to use only one column from the New York Times online every day. So, in other words, we're paying a lot of money for something that is not all that useful to us. And we do recognize the value of their columnists, which is why we paid for them for so long. But when, you know, you have to choose between Washington Post, you have a lot of great columnists there too, or New York Times, which isn't really that useful in a lot of ways and extremely expensive. I mean, it's really kind of a no-brainer, even though we don't like getting rid of Krugman or, you know, or David Brooks or any of those folks.
Well, I have a subscription to New York Times and the Oregonian.
Chris Leslie, forum member. If I'm understanding it right, the editorial page is now called the opinion page.
No, I to be honest with you, I'm not really sure what it's called. It's such a mushy title. In part, you know, my title is editorial and commentary editor. I mean, I think historically I'd be called the editorial page editor, but, you know, we're a digital operation as well as a newspaper operation, so, you know, you don't want to call attention to the paper product. So, you can call it whatever you want.
Oh, on the top of the page it says opinion.
Yeah.
I read two great opinions recently. One was Kate Brown holding her to her transparency.
Oh, thank you.
And I thought that where we stand on that and on a number of the subjects that the state legislation is taking up. Ban the box. Things like that, or filming the police. What are your comments? And the filming the police is kind of a free speech, isn't it?
I'm fine with filming the police. I think that's entirely appropriate.
Right.
In Ban the Box, I think our particular quibble with Ban the Box, now this is going to take a, I'm going to mess this up, and it's going to take a long time, but I'm going to try. So it started in Oregon with Portland City Council. Portland decided to adopt a ban the box policy. I'm trying to remember this. No, they were talking about it. And the state legislature decided, somebody correct me if I'm wrong here, but if the idea began with Portland, the legislature came in and said, okay, we're gonna do a statewide ban the box policy that was less burdensome on employers than what Portland had in mind. Portland came back last year, even before the state legislation had gone into effect, and passed a much more restrictive ban the box policy, which we objected to. I mean, our argument had been that the state had done enough. Our quibble was Portland overreaching.
I think that banning the box is just dumb. It's you don't know the person or how he's going to be an employee one way or the other. Thank you, Lee. My conscience spoke. Thank you.
Questions in one is a bit much.
Okay. Your turn, Mr. Holden.
Anyhow, Lee Coleman, forum member. How do you justify cutting the number of editorials by 3 per week.
We cut our editorial staff by 25%.
What's that?
We cut our editorial writers by 25%. Last year we had 4 people working full-time writing editorials. Mark Hester just retired. This year we went down to 3 editorial writers. So there are 3 of us, and we do all the things as well. So there are probably functionally 2.5. And we're also expanding our role in events. So it's simply a question of how much work can 3 people do. And as your staff goes down and your workload grows, you can't do everything. So it's we had to cut something. We didn't like it, but there you have it.
Mike Mahalik, forum member. And that help. There we go. I think it would be useful if you can tell people in this room, and people are going to watch the eventual YouTube, how does the newspaper come together every day and for the entire weekend? Is there some sort of long-term vision of what the newspaper needs to do month by month by month by month that's translating to weekly goals or whatever? And then there's the, what do we do every day? When is the decision made to put something together for that day's newspaper? And then the second part of that question, you specifically, is who sets the editorial tone for the Oregonian?
Okay, so the first question had to do with the way the newspaper is put together. And my role has nothing to do with that. I'm simply the editorial guy. But I've been around newspapers for a while, and I can give you a sense. The news organizations tend to do a number of things at once. They'll have a number of investigations undergoing. They'll have a number of enterprise stories in the works. They'll look at, they'll know some things are coming up, like, okay, the legislative session starts, we're going to have to allocate our resources there, and we're going to do a lot of stories there. It's governed in part by external events, some stuff that you have to cover. So you work off of a budget. You tend to like a weekly budget or a monthly budget. Okay, here's what we're going to do. This is what we're going to put in the paper. Today, tomorrow, the next day, we're going to schedule these bigger stories for these days of the week. It's just you sort of juggle your.
Related to that, like so many column inches for editorial, so many column inches for news or whatever. But like a Thursday night or whatever, who determines what's going to go in those inches?
Well, I think with the Oregonian, it's a combination of the news people and the people we call it the pub hub. They're the copy editors who actually assemble the paper product. And the reporters are encouraged not to think of, you're going to write, X inches for X days. When I was a city editor probably 5 years ago, that's what we used to do. Okay, well, here's our news hole. You're going to write 17 inches on that. People just write stuff. And the pub hub decides, or somebody decides, how to assemble all of that stuff that's already gone online into the paper product, and a lot of editing goes on. They'll cut it down to size. It's their prerogative, but it's in a lot of other places it's more regimented than it is here because of the sort of separation between sort of the digital world and the print world. In the print world you're just culling a lot of stuff I think that you'll get that we're already putting online.
And I understand. To me it seems like I understand budgeting. But it seems like the budget now is not column inches, but 8 pages on Monday, 8 pages on Tuesday, or whatever. So, but if I remember 10, 20 years ago, you never knew how big the paper was going to be until you got it. So, and then the other part of the question was the editorial direction. How is that voice created? Is it your opinion, or is there a collective mindset for Advance or the Oregonian?
Advance doesn't tell local papers what's right. So I've never, I've met the folks at Advance, they've never told me what to write or what position to take. And if you look at the different markets, they're all different. The direction is set by the editorial page editor, that's me. And I was hired in part because of my point of view. I mean, Chris Anderson, the former publisher, hired me in part because my outlook is pretty much the same as his. And it's good on an editorial board to have people who aren't all alike, and that's what we've tried to do. We have people who are from different parts of the political spectrum and who know different, have different areas of expertise. because you really want to be sort of pushed, you know, everybody should think like me, and you want people who can write about a bunch of different things. But ultimately, you know, it's my call to decide whether or not an editorial is consistent with what our view of the world is. And, you know, it doesn't, you know, you would think that that might create tension, but it doesn't, because people, after a while, they learn where the parameters are and where things can be pushed. And, you know, I've been convinced by, you know, my team to not to write something that, in retrospect, probably would have been pretty stupid. And you know, they, you know, it's a give and take. But, I mean, you know, my role is to set the parameters and to set our editorial viewpoint.
All right, thank you so much.
Sure.
Mr. Lukens, I'm Rob Solomon, paid up member of the forum because Eric makes me pay up my dues. I'm confused about the relationship between the digital product and the paper product. My confusion centers particularly around what I think might be part of your function as far as editorial is concerned. An organization, not this one, that I'm involved with, about 3 weeks ago, wrote an op-ed piece about the very serious concerns about Muslim backlash in our community, et cetera. And you guys picked up on it. It was online digitally in 20 seconds after we released it, and didn't make the paper. This is not a complaint. I'm just wondering how you decide what goes where, what goes in both places. Just toss that up to you.
And that was an op-ed. It was an opinion
piece. Yes.
In a way that the editorial page doesn't really work the way the rest of the paper works. And the rest of the paper, we're really guided in some ways by what the physical product looks like. That's what dictates what we write, when we write it. And that doesn't work that way for the rest of the paper. So we know every week that there, you know, we sort of changed it, but there used to be 6 or 7 spaces every week in the printed paper for guest columns. And we receive a lot more guest columns than that. So we have this task of continually going through the guest columns, reassigning things to pages, and picking the things that we think are of greatest interest and greatest value to readers to put in the printed product. Those always go online before they make it in print. But every once in a while, we'll see an op-ed piece that, you know, it might not make our cut for the printed product, but we think it ought to be out there anyway, and we'll just run it online.
So is it essentially because it doesn't cost anything to put it online, but it costs to put it on paper? I'm not trying to be overly simplistic, I'm just trying to make sure I've got a sense of it.
Well, the cost isn't really a function, the cost isn't really that relevant, because the cost is my time. I'm the guy who does that, right? So, you know, I
was thinking in terms of space on the page.
We have a finite amount of space in the paper, and it's, you know, it's really expensive. I mean, we have a set number of pages each week, so I mean, we work off that. So we can't create more space in the paper, but the, you know, it's sort of infinite online. So I'll put, if I have time, in, you know, I have op-eds that I would like to put up, I'll go ahead and put those up online, but I don't always have the time.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Erik Squires, Executive Director. First, great presentation. Thank you. Quick comment. I think that an underutilized part of the online product is the My Neighborhood Public Blogs. This organization has used them quite heavily, and I think it is an underutilized part of the digital property, and we're grateful that you grant us access for that. I'd like to ask you about your role as an editor as it pertains to issuing an opinion when you cannot get all the public records you need. The issue I'm nibbling at is Oregon's multiple gratuitous exemptions to public records requests. So when you're charged with rendering an opinion and you are receiving obstacles from the state or any political subdivision thereof, you can't get what you need in order to write an opinion, what do you do?
I'm not averse to writing an opinion saying, hey, look, these jerks are withholding access to public records.
Fair enough. If you want to go deeper on that subject, I would be, and other people I'm sure would be entertained. But if you have any particular frustrations that you'd like to share, I would be grateful for a response.
I'm trying to remember a time in which we did that. I mean, we write about public records from time to time. There was one instance in which we really smacked a public agency around for public records, and that was Joe Rose a couple of years ago. He was a He is no longer, but he was our transportation writer. He did a really big year-long examination of TriMet, and they had a habit of letting people work tons of overtime and getting really tired and crashing trains and stuff. And he looked at the hours people were working and, you know, which contributed to, you know, to the phenomenon. And he had a hell of a time getting any records out of them. And he would request, say, something that might be available in a spreadsheet. They wouldn't send him the spreadsheet electronically, they'd print it out. So he couldn't use it very well. And so when we wrote about this issue, we really were hard on TriMet for withholding public records. I'm trying to think. There have been a couple of other instances in the past 4 years that I've been here that we have written about public agencies stalling in public records. And I did a lot in Bend. I mean, I had a records request to the local school district, and it took them months, and I would write all the time saying, you know, here's how long it's taking, here's how long it's taking. They don't like that. A gentleman up here before mentioned an editorial that we wrote recently about the State Department of Human Services in the governor's office, which deliberately sat on a public records request. It was a plain vanilla request for months and months and months, while the legislature exempted the material from public disclosure. And then the day after the legislature did that, they wrote a response saying, "Oh, sorry, your request is moot." Well, we wrote about that, and I requested of the Department of Human Services emails from a few points in time. It was amazing how fast they got them to me. By writing about them, you really can. I mean, if you have a pulpit, you really can pressure them to, you know, to respond with more alacrity.
Thank you for your advocacy. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm McWilliams, a board member. I have a little bit of a political question. This deals with Multnomah County, City of Portland, probably. Do you have an idea of when you might come out with an endorsement for Mayor of Portland?
Let's see, we probably wouldn't do that until fairly shortly before the election. One thing that we've kind of toyed with in the past couple of years is, you know, how long in advance of an education to write an election to write an endorsement. And I think in 2014, I decided that it would be a really great idea to write endorsements pretty far, you know, a pretty good distance before the election, with the expectation that, you know, it would give candidates that we supported time to use our endorsements. Well, it turned out to be kind of stupid in a couple instances because events changed after our endorsement. You know, we're like, oh my God, why the hell did we do that? But so I think my inclination is to move endorsements closer to the election.
No, closer to May, because this will be decided in May, probably.
Yeah, I mean, it'll be before ballots go out, so ballots would go out in April, I imagine.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Erik Lukens, for a member. I'm sorry that Jim Cape left, because I wanted to add something to the comment about people who go from the newsroom to public agencies or private companies. In the old days, we referred to that as going over to the dark side. You know, I was in the news business for a number of years, and I can remember when the legislature first got around to enacting an open meetings law. I think it was 1969 or 71. And in some ways, ever since that time, the legislature, certain groups keep nibbling away at the law, so it's more and more overburdened, but sort of really conflicts with the purpose of the law. Would we be better off to go back to where there is no public records, open meetings situations?
Oh, you mean do away with open meetings and public records laws?
Just basically just abolish the law and just go free enterprise again.
Oh, no, I think we need public open meetings and public records law. We have to keep fighting against attempts to narrow them and, you know, seek ways to make public agencies provide public records more quickly. I'd hate to think of the world without open meetings laws and public records laws.
I'd love to comment on that. Just I remember a situation in Idaho where the school board was withholding. And the North Side News and Jerome would hammer them every week, 8-column banner headlines on the front. What is it they don't want you to know? It was just a direct attack, and it worked. It worked. Anyway.
Bill Kroger again. Thanks for coming in today.
Sure.
I think Portland at one time was pretty conservative, but today it's one of the most liberal cities in the country. I was kind of curious if you would talk about why your editorial policy tends toward the conservative in one of the most liberal areas of the country.
Yeah, I get that a lot. Well, because somebody hired me to do that, and that's the flip answer. But you know, I think there's a place like Portland in which you have, you know, there's sort of a sense of conventional wisdom that, you know, everyone sees, I mean, I'm exaggerating, in which everyone sees the world a certain way. You really do need people who are willing to question the conventional wisdom. And I think that it's dangerous when you don't. And I would also say that, you know, I have people come to me and say, well, why did they hire you? You know, you're more conservative than Portland, your audience is in Portland. But in fact, our audience is all over the place. We have a really huge digital reach, and we have readers from all over the state. And even people outside of Portland in the metropolitan area don't exactly think like people in Portland do. And you know, you should always assume when you're writing editorials and expressing a point of view that a lot of people out there disagree with you. So, you know, people would disagree with us whether we agreed with Portland and everything that in everything Portland did. So.
Hi, Phil Nelson, board member and a Oregonian subscriber, I guess, since October 1st, 1968.
Wow.
It's been a while. What I'm curious about, though, is climate change seems pretty obvious, pretty well accepted, and the Oregonian has apparently taken a position it's not going to be one of the editorial priorities, and yet it affects seemingly all of us. So I'm wondering, and I know you do cover it some, I mean, you don't just ignore it entirely, but I'm wondering maybe you can explain a little bit about how that came about, what you have as a way of policy regarding climate change. Thank you.
Sure. This was probably one of the most hated editorials I've ever written, by the way. We used to ask readers before this year to make suggestions for our editorial agenda. And we did this year, except because things were kind of crazy and we kind of ran out of time. And most of the, for the most part, they agreed with, you know, our basic concerns. But the number one thing that people told us that we ought to be writing, you know, included in our agenda is climate change. And I'll explain in a minute why that isn't on there. But I figured, you know, in late 2014, I'd explain to people why climate change wasn't on our editorial agenda. And wow. Anyway, the reason it isn't on our editorial agenda is primarily our state and local focus. We are focused entirely on state and local policies and concerns. And in our view, climate change is best handled through national and international cooperation. And what happens in Oregon is you have public policies that are designed to act on a state level that don't really get you very far in terms of climate change and end up costing you a whole lot of money, like the low carbon fuel standard, which is something that we wrote about again and again. And Oregon also has a long track record of handling complex programs really badly. When you look back to the business energy tax credit and so forth. And, you know, in our view, this is just something that Oregon is better off not going cowboy on and letting it play out nationally, internationally.
Virginia Bruce, forum member, publisher of the Cedar Mill News, which is a hyper-local publication here in Washington County. Washington County is often called the economic engine of Oregon, and we have lots of complex political things going on, and yet you guys are slashing coverage out here. Got rid of a bunch of the local reporters who knew the situation, cutting way back on your local publications. Why?
I'm here to talk about opinion. You're talking about news coverage. That's not my area.
Well, is there some philosophical? I mean, you just mentioned that you're not very good at covering complex subjects. Maybe that's why you're avoiding
one. No, that comment has to do with the state of Oregon handling complex programs.
Okay.
And what you're asking is a question about straight news coverage, and that's a question. I mean, if you want an answer to that, I'd recommend you invite Mark Katches out here.
Chris Leslie, board member, second time. The opinions in that one article were mainly on the state legislation. How closely are you holding them to the, well, to the point of not, I mean, bomb threats? Isn't that already a law against bomb threats? A lot of these points that you brought out in that opinion are editorial, were things that should already be common logic laws.
Can you give me some examples? I'm trying to, in which editorial?
The bomb threats. I can give you a list.
What editorial?
Yeah, what was the editorial?
January 1st. It was opinion again. Birth control, sick leave, pumping your own gas, things like that are sort of common logic.
Yeah.
And as a conservative, don't you use a lot of logic?
I think liberals use logic too. But I mean, we just see that. And I'm not entirely conservative. I'm a libertarian. So you're talking about something like pumping gas? Yeah, I think it's crazy that we can't pump our own gas, but that's the law.
Well, the bomb threats, isn't that a law already?
What is the, I'm not sure I understand the reference to bomb threats.
Somebody phoning up a school and saying there's a bomb in your school. Isn't that already against the law?
Sure, I can't recall that we've written about that, though.
Well, that was one of the items.
Yeah, let's see.
Maybe I'm not getting it right, but it was along those lines. Are you following up on these opinions?
Yeah, I mean, if we're laying out an editorial agenda and we're saying that the legislature ought to be doing X, Y, and Z or shouldn't be doing X, Y, and Z, we, as the legislative session progresses, we will keep track of that and follow up.
Thank you.
Sure.
Erik Squires, Executive Director. I guess I can close the show here. I'd like to talk about, in the format of a question, something the Oregonian's Editorial Review Board, the editors have championed. That is the urban-rural divide in Oregon. And the premise of my question is based this way. I found myself driving from Lakeview up to Burns and through Dayville and up to, well, just through Central Oregon, and I was aghast by the economic conditions that I saw. Contractions, vacant homes. We have a cottage industry of photographers based in the Portland metro area that drive Oregon to take pictures of what's broken in the rest of Oregon. And so I was smitten that the Oregonian not only championed, but continues to champion this issue. I'm wondering if you could help me and the rest of this body understand what motivations, what instances, what actions that you saw as an editorial body drove you to champion the urban-rural division in Oregon and the economic meltdown in, say, Eastern Oregon?
Well, I think that we have an obligation to respond to problems, you know, across the state. We're not just a Portland newspaper. The fact is that the Portland metropolitan area is doing a lot better than a lot of the rest of the state. And, you know, I worked for a long time in Bend, and I saw a lot of, you know, I paid attention to a lot of issues from Eastern Oregon and from Central Oregon. And, you know, you talk to a lot of people out there, you watch people trying to build things, and you realize that, you know, they're very frustrated by the fact that, you know, the land use system, for instance, is something that is really kind of safeguarded in the Portland metropolitan area, but it has effects on Eastern Oregon that, you know, I talked to Cliff Bentz, who's a representative from Ontario, the other day, and, you know, he said, well, you know, I feel like with federal land, you know, it's sort of controlled by people on the East Coast, and private land is controlled by people in Portland. You can't build houses in places where, you know, people in just across the river, wherever in Idaho can. And there is this disconnect, I think, between the way the legislature, you know, handles the land use system, a lot of regulatory things, in the way that people in rural areas are affected. I'm not explaining that very well, but I mean, you know, one specific example that I think you know, we've written about this time and time again, is the Jordan Cove liquid, you know, natural gas export facility, which has had at best begrudging support from the governor, whether it's Kitts Harbor or Brown, and would actually be a big deal to folks over there, and it would generate a lot of money for the local economy and so forth. You know, those jobs are not insignificant. That probably didn't answer your question very well.
Actually, I think you did a surprisingly good job. You acknowledged the point, and you gave me some examples, which is what I was looking for. I just think that it's an issue that, well, forgive me. Folks, sorry, I think that you did a great job. You answered my point, and you gave me some examples. Where I'm pleased is that it's an issue that the Portland bubble does not see, and it's only the people who exit Portland and get in and not only just drive through, but stop and see the deplorable, the abysmal economic conditions that I'm grateful, because we live in a state and not in a Portland area metroplex. And the editorial review board has cast a rather unflattering light on that. And so I would not sell yourself short. I think you attacked the question, but it's a very vague, big question. Nonetheless, it is a question that the Oregonian has championed. And I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, just a brief moment to thank Erik Lukens for a wonderful presentation. Thank you. This is just my opinion, but it can't be easy in such a changing industry to give people a snapshot while the newspaper industry is changing everywhere. So again, thank you very much. Really appreciate it. And folks, not only on the 18th, 1 week from today, will we be learning about the legislative session and the insight involved, but also on the 17th, let me flag you, on the 17th, Sunday at 4 o'clock at Southminster Church, the Washington County Human Rights Council, the Everton Human Rights Commission, and the Interfaith Action Network will have a wonderful celebration of the Martin Luther King Day. And then we're on the next day with our insightful look at the legislature. Ladies and gentlemen.
Happy birthday to you.
Seldom a man of few words, I just simply would like to say thank you very much. And I give a quick nod to Facebook, because I don't think this could have happened without the publication. Thank you very much, it's very kind of you. See you next week.